Okay. So, my name is Branislav Zahradník. My CPAN ID is Barney, and a lot of information. I work for Good Data. We are in Czech Republic. Obviously, we are hiring Perl programmers as well. And I would like to talk today about domain-driven development with Context Singleton. I will split this presentation into two parts. First is explanation of domain-driven development or design. Has somebody experience with it? Just for curiosity. Okay. And second part will be some examples and explanation how to do some things I will mention with the Context Singleton library. So, why domain-driven development is so important in important in software development is that it focus to deliver the business value and to keep the domain experts and developers on the same page using the same language, same terms. So there will be no two different words, like one is a business, second is a software development, and they cannot speak each other, because business use one terms, customer use another terms, and development use third term, and who knows what it is. So in the domain driven development, everything is split into small parts with its own domain language, which is consistent across the whole chain. The English word ubiquitous, I think. In a domain, it describes every change in the domain, and it is used everywhere where you communicate with this domain. It also aimed to improve software quality. But how to measure it? What it is? Number of bugs, the maintenance effort, or the effort to put some improvements? It depends on type of the software. And yeah, it's never clear this answer. So, domain-driven development focuses to split your problem into small parts. They are called bounded context. Bounded contexts are things which are close together and are important. All of them are important for this bounded context. The example from the book Domain-Driven Distilled is the ticket system, like Jira, for example, or whatever. As you see, the username, like assignee reporter, is not there, because it is not important for the process managing tickets in the backlog or sprints. User is not important then. Using user as assignee or any other roles, it's another bounded context which uses this one and context user. And to imagine that if it will be in the bigger scale, that bounded context will like, or you can replace it with a microservice. It is completely independent on the rest of the system. Also what is important is to define and well define the domain language. It's a language which describes everything what happens in the domain. And it will be good if it will be human language, so you can say, like, for example, project owner can assign a ticket to the backlog and can make a release or whatever. And with this language, you will describe the processes, you will describe the tests. What is advantage of it? That domain expert who has no clue about the Perl can write the tests using the domain language and can understand and verify the tests, that they are describing the what domain should do. And of course, one thing is that as in human language, some words have different meanings in the different context. And it's okay to use them, use those words to describe exactly the context in the domain where they are natural. Like account in the bank is a different meaning as account in the user authorization. But the word is the same. Domain event, it's another term. It's a description of what happened in the domain. So it usually is in a past tense, like user was created, ticket was assigned to the backlog, with all necessary information. Domain event is a result of the action which came from the outside world to the domain. Like it's called domain command. And in a function or object-oriented programming, is a if you call add ticket to the backlog, and the result is ticket was added. It can introduce eventual consistency, so your system should be able to understand that and to treat the information as valid after they were confirmed. And also domain event can be observed, so that's the way how you receive the observation confirmation that action that you triggered was executed. And as I mentioned, that tests should be written in domain language. And so preparation will be description what domain events already happened in the domain. Then your act will be domain command, and then you will verify what domain events already exist in the domain. Should be clear, should be easy to understand, especially for newbies in your domain or newcomers. They can walk through the test and they can understand what your system is doing. They don't need to see the code, ideally. So, how to implement it with context singleton? What I'm using is what I called a flat model. That context is a flat description of the domain or domain events, what I have. And the validation is like applying the constraint on this flat structure, checking whether I already have values or domain events happened in the system or in the context. If I don't, then I try to calculate them and calculate. It's like Prolog or any logical programming similar. So proclaim and deduce, they can be used to evaluate value objects. Deduce can also act as a domain command which returns domain event. And trigger is the thing for observing events where you can react that something happened in the system or for in a remote context. This is example with trigger. In this case, if a project ID will be populated in an actual context, then this function will be called, and as a result, MDC in the logger will be populated with the value. So after that, every log line will contain this project ID as it everything happened with this project ID. Okay, this is a little bit more tricky. I'm using few terms which describes internal state of the bounded context, and then I'm telling the system which bounded context to choose. So I have a generic workflow with how to backup the project with username, password, and what project, and then how to save the backup. So where to save the backup? As an example, I choose Amazon S3, but can be I don't know what, any cloud service, any remote service or tape device or whatever. And here you just choose the implementation you want. Of course, it's more way how to do it. Vice versa, I'm using the NetAmazon S3 as a upload system, which requires the access key and secret key, and then I'm providing the mapping that the domain, which is in NetAmazon S3 called access key, is in fact my domain storage username. With this mapping and with this the rule, if I ask to upload the file, then the NetAmazon S3 object will be populated via class using NetAmazon S3 access key and secret key, which will be taken from my domain backup storage. How to write the tests? Again, inject the state with the proclaim. So I will populate the vol state when I'm testing. I trigger the domain command, and then I can assert any domain event because it already exists. Even it may not exist, will be calculated, but still in the test it will be in the control state. So it always has to have a same name. Therefore, for example, here I'm using proclaim now. So the test will be evaluated always at the same time, thinking it's the same time, because assigned URI in this case uses the time as a in a signature. So every time you calculate it, it produces different result. Therefore, I need exact time. And another thing I'm using this library for is implementation of API versioning. Well, I have two parsers which can produce the domain I'm recognizing. So for version 1 and version 2, user login taken from version 1 is just a plain key login. User login from version 2 is a deeper from structure user and key login name. But still, I will proclaim that I have this version depending on the content type, which can be one of these. And then if I call authorize user, then it will use user login and it will automatically choose which one to use because of the dependencies. So you can have a multiple version of your public API or view of the public API and still internally using the same domains or same facts, and you don't need to change a workflow. But if you need to change the workflow, you can also write similar transformation function as I used for this backup access key to transform one version of user login to another version and back. The opposite way, how to build the output, is again the same example. Output for version 1 is constructed as a structure login password. Another one is as a structure user with structure login password. So the same approach. And if you want to learn more, these are three books available. I read and they are ordered by how I think are easy to understand. So from the easiest to hardest. Yeah, that's all. Questions? Any questions or what?
Yeah, we've got time for, we've got 6 minutes before lunch. I don't know if this is the they'll have it ready early, so feel free to ask. Any questions?
In both. Okay, I will repeat the question for video. So whether to use context singleton only for testing or also in production. Yes, you cannot use it in test if you don't use it in production, because your code should use the context singleton patterns, so you can inject those patterns in the tests. So the answer is yes for both in production and in tests. One slide I had to write, as I see at the time, is that how to refactor old code, for example. In this case, many arguments of existing functions are in fact something that narrows your context. So you have a context like in a REST API. First come request. So that's the first context. Then you identify project ID, as in my case, that it's new context, so you create a new context, proclaim project ID, and then everything that can be resolved from the project ID, like database connections or whatever, is automatically available and resolved in your frame, so you don't need any of these value as an argument of any function. And then down and down. Yes, it is sort of dependency injection. Okay. I'm sorry?
I have a question about cucumber. Like,
yeah, cucumber. The question is whether you can use Cucumber. Why not? But you need to write the drivers, and I didn't yet. Okay. So any behavioral testing can use it, because it is behavioral testing. But without driver yet. The question is how I'm resolving dependencies. Well, I'm using listener notifier pattern. So every time when you create when you ask for the new the singleton to be resolved, if it is not available yet, then it builds the pattern or the tree of all its dependencies. And with listener notifier, it will automatically know whether it can be deduced or not. So, and that will be preserved in every frame. So it's quite fast, and it solves also circular dependencies. So, if it can be solved but it's not available, then it can find which rule can be applied, and then call it to resolve its these dependencies and then build it. It's just such simple pattern. Should be more sophisticated, but it's enough for my use case. And feel free to use it. Feel free to comment. Feel bugs, issues, and I cannot think about all use cases. That's just. That's all. Okay, thank you.